William Carey is almost certainly the most well-known missionary in Baptist history. Had there been no William Carey, it is uncertain whether there would have ever been an Adoniram Judson, Lottie Moon, or Bill Wallace. Carey has been called the father of the modern missions movement in the English-speaking world because of his 40-plus years as a missionary in India and the role he played as a missions apologist. Carey was converted while working as a blacksmith's apprentice as a teenager and then baptized by a Baptist pastor named John Ryland Jr. in 1783. Carey pastored a village church in Malton, Northamptonshire, but because the church was unable to financially support the Carey family, he also worked as a grammar school teacher and a shoe cobbler. William was still a teenager, not quite 20 in the summer of 1781 when he married Dorothy. She was nearly 6 years his senior. There is no indication theirs was a love match, but the marriage lasted until her death 26 years later. William and Dorothy had little in common. She was illiterate at the time of their marriage. She signed an X in the parish marriage register. Carey might have waited and married a woman whose capabilities and interests more closely paralleled his own, but he did not. It would be mistaken, however, to imagine that Dorothy had shrewdly snared the hometown's most eligible bachelor. He was described as a poor journeyman shoemaker, and during the dozen years before he sailed for India, he was never able to bring his family above the poverty level when his mother visited them at the time of their baby daughter's death. She was appalled by their abject poverty. But despite the Carey's financial hardships, there is no evidence Dorothy was dissatisfied with her marriage or circumstances in life. William's pastoral duties at a tiny Baptist church consumed precious time and energy with inadequate compensation. Yet she supported him to the point of consenting to be rebaptized as a Baptist, a noteworthy decision considering her devout Puritan upbringing. Although Carey was mostly uneducated, he was a voracious reader who became very interested in literature about foreign lands, especially Captain James Cook's journals of his travels. This curiosity about other lands slowly became a spiritual concern for the salvation of foreign peoples. Carey increasingly mentioned unevangelized nations in his sermons and wept when he discussed those with little access to the gospel. A young minister in the Northamptonshire Association, Carey became close friends with other young pastors like Ryland Jr., John Sutcliffe, and Andrew Fuller. He was influenced by their evangelical Calvinism, which, unlike the dominant hyper-Calvinism of the era, included a commitment to evangelistic urgency. When Carey attended the 1785 meeting of the association's ministers fraternal, he was invited to propose a topic for the pastors to discuss. Carey proposed whether the command given to the apostles to teach all nations was not obligatory on all succeeding ministers to the end of the world, seeing that the accompanying promise was of equal extent. Carey had come to believe that the Great Commission of Matthew 28:18-20 was a binding command on every generation of Christians. John Collett Ryland, the father of John Ryland Jr., publicly rebuked Carey at the meeting, calling the young pastor a miserable enthusiast. The topic was not discussed that day. In May 1792, Carey published his treatise An Inquiry in the Obligations of Christians to Use Means for the Conversion of the Heathens, a manifesto calling upon the particular Baptists to engage in foreign missions. Later that spring, Carey was asked to preach the associational sermon before the 1792 meeting of the Northamptonshire Association. His text was Isaiah 54:2-3. But Dorothy's support for her husband's ministry had its limits. When he announced he had volunteered to become a missionary in India, she adamantly refused to be part of the venture. There is no evidence William had previously shared his dreams with Dorothy. And his decision came suddenly, not at home with Dorothy at his side, but at a Baptist Missionary Society meeting in a neighboring town. William reluctantly acquiesced to her refusal to join him, but he did insist on taking their oldest child, Felix. Why did Dorothy oppose serving with her husband as a foreign missionary? Critics have charged not only a lack of wifely submission, but also spiritual impotence. But considering the departure was immediate, the cross-cultural move was permanent, and the venture was woefully underfunded, it is not difficult to understand her frame of mind. Even if they endured the long sea voyage, would they survive the disease-ridden tropical climate of India? She had endured many hardships, but this was asking too much, especially to say good-bye to family and friends with no hope of seeing them again. She was described as a homebird who was home, clinging to a degree. Her people, as the registers prove, had for a century at least kept close to one another, sharing all their sunshines and griefs within the bounds of the village. She must have hoped her husband would change his mind, but he did not. On April 4, 1793, William Carey abandoned his pregnant wife and two little children and boarded the Oxford on the Thames to begin his voyage to India. He was accompanied by his son Felix and his missionary partner, John Thomas, as well as Mrs. Thomas and their daughter. The voyage ended almost as quickly as it began, however, when Thomas was forced to return and settle debts before leaving. The delay gave William as well as John Thomas additional time to urge Dorothy, who had just come through a safe delivery, to change her mind. Carey utilized kind words and subtle implications in his effort to persuade her. "If I had all the world, I would freely give it all to have you and my dear children with me," he wrote while on board the Oxford. "But the sense of duty is so strong as to overpower all other considerations. I could not turn back without guilt on my soul. You want to know what Mrs. Thomas thinks, and how she likes the voyage. She would rather stay in England than go to India, but thinks it right to go with her husband." Thomas was not so subtle. He told Dorothy her refusal to join the venture would cause her family to be dispersed and divided forever. She would repent it as long as she lived. On May 9, 1808, just 5 months and a day after Dorothy's death, Carey married Charlotte Romore, a Danish woman not connected with the mission. He had known her since she had moved to India several years earlier, and she had become a baptized believer through his ministry. She was described as petite, elegant, well-educated, cultured, and wealthy, a stark contrast from Dorothy. William and Charlotte were both 46, and in many ways she was a perfect match for Carey. But their marriage created no small scandal in the mission. So agitated were some missionaries when they learned of William's intent to remarry so soon, they circulated a petition to dissuade him. Carey's determination prevailed, however, and they withdrew their protest. Fortunately for Carey, this marriage was happy. He and Charlotte worked together on translations, and she became a loving mother to the younger boys, who had never lived in a functional family. When she died in 1821, after 13 years of marriage, Carey wrote, "We had as great a share of happiness as ever was enjoyed by mortals." 2 years after Charlotte's death, Carey, now 62, married for the third time. The bride was Grace Hughes, a widow 17 years younger. Grace was no match for Charlotte in intelligence or culture, but she was a good companion for Carey's remaining 11 years. "Her constant and unremitting care and excellent nursing took off much of the weight of my illness," he wrote, adding, "We live in great happiness." But it was Charlotte who had truly captured William Carey's heart. When he died in 1834, his will specified that Grace should receive his valuable library, but that he be buried by the side of my second wife, Charlotte Amelia Carey. Building a communal family. Carey's home involved more than the nuclear family. After he located in the Danish settlement of Sarampri in 1800, Carey formulated a pattern for communal family living. All missionaries and their family members would share meals and devotional times and live out of a common treasury. The purpose was to bring family life and ministry together in order to enhance both. Earlier Carey had written, "Our families should be considered nurseries for the mission." For Carey, as well as the other Sarampri missionaries, that ideal became a reality as their children continued on in the work of the mission. Carey's own legacy includes nephews and sons and later generations of missionary enthusiasts. His son Jabez, like Felix, started young, language study at 13 and ordination and commissioning at age 18. But not all went according to Carey's plans. His nephew Eustace established a rival mission station. Carey's son Felix abandoned his missionary work in Burma in 1814 to serve as an ambassador for the King of Burma. Carey was devastated. Felix is shriveled from a missionary into an ambassador. Carey's children were important to him, but the ministry came first. This was evident when his son William, who was serving with his young wife at a remote mission outpost, was gored by a buffalo. Discouraged and fearing for his wife's safety, William requested a transfer back to Sarampri. Carey's words to his son exemplify his lifelong perspective on family relationships. "I ought, however, to say that I think there is much guilt in your fears. You and Mary will be 1,000 times more safe in committing yourselves to God in the way of duty than in neglecting the obvious duty to take care of yourselves." During Carey's long life, he nearly always enjoyed good health. Thrice he despaired of his life and thrice he recovered by the grace of God. When the last revised edition of the Bengali Bible came from the press, he felt his labors were near the end. He had hosts of friends because to the very last he maintained a cheerful, hopeful disposition. Once he said to a friend, "There is nothing remarkable in what I have done. It has only required patience and perseverance." At another time he said, "When I compare things as they now are in India with what they were when I came here, I see that a great work has been accomplished, but how it has been accomplished, I know not." To a friend who had expressed the hope that he might return to his loved work soon he said, "The passage which says, 'If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins, and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness,' gives me much comfort. For," he added further, "I am sure I confess my sins, and if God forgives them and cleanses me from all unrighteousness, what more can I desire?" As his infirmities increased he was carried down into his study each morning, and sat by the desk where he did all his translating. Here once Alexander Duff called on him. As he withdrew Dr. Carey said, "Mr. Duff, you have been talking about Dr. Carey. Dr. Carey, when I am gone, say nothing about Dr. Carey, speak about Dr. Carey's Savior." 19. On thy kind arms. The day opened with cheering letters from England, telling of sympathy, love and prayers in his behalf. These messages caused the last vibrations of his ever-cheerful heart to be gratitude to God for his goodness. Through weakness that day he passed into delirium, and on June 9, 1834, he fell asleep, for the Shining Ones came and took the silver-haired pilgrim to the heavenly city. He was carried to his burial the next morning at 5. Rain was falling, yet the Danish governor and his wife and the council joined the procession. The Danish flag hung at half-mast, poor Hindus and Mohammedans lined the road, feeling they had lost a true friend. As the procession halted at the open grave the sun broke forth, a resurrection hymn was sung and men turned away thanking God for the life that had touched theirs. On the block of marble marking his last resting place in the Serampore Christian burial grounds are these words inscribed, "Thank you for watching. God bless you."